Okay, 1:30, we resume our recess meeting for this morning. 1:30, Corey Swanson.
Hello.
Any issues, good issue, bad issue, whatever?
Is there anybody here from R&R Construction? Is Jeremy Badness coming? I spoke to him last week a couple times and I thought he was coming, but I wasn't entirely sure. I don't think I nailed it down.
Just about every day there last week, he was over there at the meeting, but he didn't say anything.
Okay. Well, I'm gonna hand out. I broke my own rule in that I didn't bring extra copies, so I'll give my document at the end to Ann. And then if anyone wants extra copies. So commissioners, what I had done here is I've given you a packet of several documents. First is an email between me and Brian Hopkins from Mako. The next is a one-page invoice from R&R Construction. Next is a contract signed between Broward County, R&R Taylor Construction. The next one is a contract between Broward County and R&R Taylor Construction. And then the last section is standard general conditions of a construction contract. And I didn't include the whole thing is 75 pages or 74 or something like that. But I included the cover and the table of contents and then Article 16, which is the part of the contract that would apply to this. So just walk you through those real fast before we go farther. As far as the contract itself goes, on page 4 of the contract, under Article 9, it says, here are the contract documents. And so all the documents that are associated there and listed under Article 9 are part of the agreement between Broward County and R&R. And included in that is general conditions. That's number 5. So under general conditions, page 4 of the one that says written agreement or contract. So that you just finished that document. Go back pages. Go back about 4 pages there. And item number 5 lists all the documents that are in that are considered part of the project. Right there.
Article 5, that's what you're talking about.
It is Article 9, sorry. Oh. Article 9. On page 4.
Okay.
So it lists all the things that are part of this actual agreement, okay? Then, so these standard conditions are part of the contract. And the standard, like I said, I didn't print the whole thing, but I printed Article 16 because that's the part that would apply here. Under Article 16, suspension of work and termination, there's several different categories. Owner may suspend work, which is what we've done. Owner may terminate for cause, that's 1602, and then you go to 1603, owner may terminate for convenience. So, owner may terminate for convenience, we would need to The owner may, upon written notice, without cause and without prejudice to any other rights or remedies, terminate the contract. The contractor will be paid for without duplication, and it lists 3 things. Completed and acceptable work, executed according to it. Expenses sustained prior to the termination in performing services and preparing, etc. And number 3, other reasonable expenses. And then B, contractor shall not be paid on account of loss of anticipated overhead profits or revenue or other economic loss arising out of or resulting from such termination. So I sent an email to Brian Hopkins with my assessment of that, as well as the fact that we received an invoice from R&R Taylor for just under $22,000 for work that they had done basically in preparation for this project or expenses they had incurred. spoken to Jeremy Fadness a couple times on this. I left messages for the contractor. I was not able to actually talk to him directly. He has talked to him a couple times. They have not indicated to him that there's a bill beyond the $22,000 that they're seeking. He did have discussions with them about the specific provision of the contract that I just showed you. So I guess what I would say is this. Number one, under this contract provision, the owner has the right to terminate for convenience, which is, if that's what you want to do, you can do that. Because I've received what I have, both in written and then verbal indirectly through Jeremy, I have not had a chance to talk directly to the contractor. My understanding of their representation is that this is the amount of money they're seeking from the county. I haven't had them say, we disclaim all other. Even if they told me that verbally, it doesn't prevent them from later, if they decide to sue or if they decide that there are other expenses they're not aware of. But what I would want to do is recommend that we reach an actual written agreement with them saying we're going to terminate. Here's the costs that R&R Taylor have expended or borne. The county will pay those, and there's nothing else associated with this contract.
That's kind of that invoice.
Right.
I think I saw right
this. What I would like to do, if the commission decides to terminate the project, is give me the opportunity to actually reach a written agreement with them to that effect. Okay. The other thing I would say is, if the commission wants to, and this isn't so much legal advice, it's just kind of practicality, if you want to cancel the project, I would just say do some exploratory looking of, if you're going to do it, how do we make whatever the current need is, it needs to be better, or down the road, 2 years down the road, or however long, if there is need for more search and rescue storage capacity, or the other tenants of the building. So that's really beyond what I would tell you strictly on legal review on this. What I would just say is, if you're going to cancel this, I believe you have legal authority to do it, and I believe that the liability that we're going to be exposed to is what's limited in Article 16. The initial indication I have is that it's going to be $22,000. And if you want to direct me to, if you want to go down that road, you should direct me to take a couple more steps to finalize this as an agreement with R&R Taylor, that this is what we would owe them, and get a written agreement to that effect. And then as an addition to that, I would say, this thing's gone for a couple of years, it's gone through about three different lives. Whatever ultimately you decide to do, you have the time under this 90-day stop provision now to kind of make your assessment of what you want to do. Whether fix the current building, whether you have a different idea in mind for a couple of years down the road, or whether you look at it and go, this is actually the best bang for our buck. I'm the farthest thing from an expert on that. But you have the opportunity now with a 90-day stop, or an end-day pause, basically, to still gather that information before you finalize the decision. In the meantime, what I would like to do is tell you, I believe this is what our liability exposure is. I would like to engage with R&R, if you direct me, engage with them to reach an agreement that that's what we need. Is that helpful?
Yeah. I think there's already plans in the way anyway, on this, like search and rescue and that kind of stuff. But maybe a discussion, Wayne, that you have to the city.
Well, I've talked to the search and rescue and looked at their building that they're in right now and had a couple of ideas for them. That would also include a shower and bathroom facility for the whatever purposes the rest of any other crews would have at their site, and that other facility would not would be tied to that building, but they would have no access to search and rescue's facilities. And we also talked about building a building at the lake would be more favorable for them, and a small extension on their building towards the alley, we could alleviate the problem of parking the truck and the boat, or the truck and the command center in that building. And with some grade work, we can straighten out the water problem that they have there. And they said that they would be more towards leaning that way than this new building. And I think we'd accommodate weeds and mosquito pretty well over at the county shop where they're at right now with a couple of small things done there. And this building to me doesn't make any sense. I mean, I realize we need office space and stuff, but I think this thing's way above what we need. I think that I would make the motion to have Corey talk to R&R and proceed with canceling this project.
Is there a second?
I will second for discussion. I haven't heard anything about extension and your plans there, and that's fine. One of my frustrations is money. Now, I know we're talking about $22,000 here from the contractor so far. We had engineering and architecture work done with WWC for the $400,000 project, which addressed all our needs, more real estate for search and rescue, the office and meeting space for everybody else, which needs to be included in this. 4-H, weed, mosquito extension. They are the partners in this, and they're really the ones who started this. But the minimal engineering that we had done for the $400,000 project wasn't enough, and a 2-1 vote of the commission, Franklin and Mike, voted to have a full engineering done for a full design bid build to the tune of another $22,000 to $30,000. I don't know what the total is. If the plan was always to try and kill this project, why did you vote, Franklin, to move ahead with the secondary engineering for the $25,000 to $30,000? That's one of my frustrations with this.
For one thing, on that bid, what they had before.
Can I ask a question before I do?
Yeah.
Did you mean to say Commissioner Slifka and
Corfalls?
Correct.
Okay.
What did I say? I said Nick.
You said Mike, and I thought I heard you say Mike.
You said
and
Mike.
Oh, I'm sorry, Mike. I meant Nick.
Sorry to interrupt.
No, you're right. Sure, in thought. Anyway, back on that. Absolutely. What there was before, there was no way it could bid. All the local contractors come in, so there's no way it could bid. This other contracts did the same thing. There was no set of specs. You're going to have a set of specs. You got to have done right, and that's what was done. $400,000. This, the low bid come in over $200,000 above the original plan of $400,000. And with the things that has to be done on top of that, I said all along, it's going to be at least $700,000, $750,000 project is what it's going to be.
Okay, you're confusing the two, but that's okay. We did have locals. We had a local contractor for concrete. We had Townsend Electric. We had Montana Post Frame, and we had H&H. Those are all locals, and they all bid that $400,000 project. But again, the needs remain. If you want to research the building we have currently, we have had it looked at by engineers. We haven't had it engineered. They came back with a $70,000 price tag to do what you're discussing.
$70,000 on what?
Well, and you're aware of this already, Franklin. We have it in writing. The current building, the doors were freezing shut. It's below grade. We have French drains that flood into that building. It doesn't have a heating system for their meeting room. Their meeting room is too small to conduct any trainings. And the shower bathroom issues.
Mike already addressed those issues right there. Besides that, just before I come in here, I was down at Senex. Search and Rescue stopped and talked to me. And he says, as far as his new building is, he says, we're better off with the old one. And those issues, just like Mike had just talked about, because Mike went to one of their meetings. Was it a regular Search and Rescue meeting, Mike, or whatever it was that time?
Search and Rescue.
And you looked at the building and stuff. And they're, well, I'm happy with what Mike had addressed.
Okay, so my concerns over Wynn is the one who called it a band-aid on a bullet wound. That building is bullet wound. I'm just thinking that the wisdom of spending, 50-ish right now for nothing, and then more money for a Band-Aid on a bullet wound. It's poor planning moving ahead. Our needs remain, our needs will grow as we grow, and the costs are only gonna go up. This is your decisions. I was a supporter of the $400,000 building project. I stand behind that. I'm gonna lose this vote on a 2-1, I'm sure, but I wanted to bring up those questions. And again, 4-H, extension, this is an ag community. We do not, cannot ditch our agricultural producers or our departments that support ag. So that's all I have.
Any other discussion? Motion for this, been moved and seconded. Now, if I can rephrase it the right way, it was to have, Mike, if I'm saying this wrong, or do you want to restate that motion? It is to have, to cancel it and have Corey get a hold of R&R?
Yes. To have Corey move ahead with negotiations with R&R to cancel the contract.
Okay. All in favor of that?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
No, and my dissenting comment is, Broadwater County used to have a reputation as a place where our word is our bond. Broadwater County no longer can stand by our word or our bond.
I don't know how you're saying that. I've had people, after you stopped me on the street, call me. And there was quite an article in the paper about that too, I see. It says, whatever it was, to cancel, get out of that project. Which is what we're doing right now, so. Corey?
So here's what I'll do. I'll first have Jeremy send them a stop letter, and then I will set up a meeting with them with an agreement of, we're gonna cancel it under this or this provision of the contract. They've submitted this invoice. I'll ask for the details of the billing associated with that invoice. And then the goal would be to come back to you at a meeting soon with an agreement that they've signed and you can sign, or that we'll all sign together. And that be the end of it, with language of limiting liability, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay?
Okay. Have you got any other issues to...
Just one that I just became aware of. The airport is working toward a construction and expansion project, and I believe they want to do it this summer. Is that correct?
Oh, and, yeah, that's repair and stuff.
Yeah, and so that requires city and county approval, and I'm aware there's a big bundle of documents. I haven't seen them yet, but the city council is going to be going over it tonight. So I will. I need to look at them before it's done. Yeah. I haven't done that yet. Tonight I have to do city council, and then I have a conservation district meeting. But
they're in the clerk and recorder's office.
Have you reviewed and have you guys looked at them? And
I just glanced at them.
Okay.
We've been requested to actually act on them.
Do you know
we have
deadline?
An email. He's asking for it today. This was an email sent by our engineer, Bill Berglund, to Franklin, Laura, and Mike. He sent a collection of paperwork to the county for the summer's pavement maintenance project at the Townsend Airport on 2/9/17. Hopefully it's on today's agenda. Please feel free to call with any questions. The city is set to review and sign forms at tonight's meeting. If it is possible for you to review, sign, and forward your copies to the city for their actions tonight, that would be great. Otherwise, we'll make something work. After discussion, I split the cap package into 3 sets, sending 2 to you and 1 to Mike Millay. So you have a package. My intention of sending 3 copies was to get 1 back signed and have 1 each for city and county records. But FAA and RPA now work with scanned copies, so that is all we really need. Thanks for your assistance, and let me know if you need anything. Sincerely, Bill. So we need to actually do some action with this.
Yeah, they're at the conference when the engineers are talking. Actually, what this is I don't know if they're going to mail out some of the paving that's there, because they can only build up so much. And then a crack ceiling, and then it's about, I don't know, at least 5 or 10 years down the road when they're gonna do the repaving, which is the big project.
Okay, so I spoke with Mike Millay today, and he is on the airport board, so he's aware of it. Mayor Evans may be aware of it. None of the other council members have looked at these documents, and so I can't tell you for sure if the city's gonna approve it tonight. They may not. they may want to wait and actually review it, but I believe it's on their agenda. So, can I get one of these sets to review?
Sure.
So go to the one.
There's only one set, that's the set right there.
Oh, I thought it said there were two to the county and one to the city. Did you get three, two sets?
Don't know.
Let's see what we got here. See what's in here.
Whoa!
Just kidding. Have you guys, have any of you reviewed it?
Nope.
There's two sets of everything here. Can move on with your agenda. I'll sit over here and divide this into two piles, two packets. And can I take one with me to review it and then bring it back to commissioners and leave one set for the commissioners with the plans?
Fine by me.
Fine.
All right?
Yeah.
Okay. I'm okay. I have nothing else unless you guys have.
Oh, okay.
I do have something for you. It's easy, I think. We have been asked by the clerk and recorders of the state and election administrators to support the mail ballot. There was an email sent earlier today, and I don't know if you got it, but it talked about some of the money. It cost over $3 million for the last election, which was a record for the state, up from $2 million from the previous general elections. So elections administrators, based on how little time there is between now and when the election will be, to fill Representative Ryan Zinke's seat, they are asking for a mail ballot for that one election alone. The commission has approved to sign a letter both to the legislature as well as to Representative Flynn and Senator Sales, voicing our support. And what I was thinking, this actually was brought to me by another elected official, that it would be a stronger letter if it came from the entire leadership team of Broadwater County. I didn't get a chance at lunch to get any other signatures, but would you be willing to sign supporting the mail ballot for this one election?
For this, here's my question on that. There was discussion that it might be combined in May with the school election, which is all mail ballot. Do you know if that's, has there been any discussion on that?
At this point,
they don't know that, because I guess there's a 90-day requirement.
From whenever he's converted.
Right.
Or well, so, from whenever he resigned.
So it may or may not work out. This bill is, if it doesn't work out, if it does, then, you know, this could still be challenged, putting it with that election. If they
is it legislation in the session right now?
Mm-hmm. Okay. It was heard yesterday at 2 o'clock.
Can you hop in?
I know there were an awful lot of county commissioners there.
The only concern I would have is because is in the last election in Montana, there were two or three, I don't know that it was widespread, but there were two or three reported instances of people volunteering to pick up people's ballots and mail them for them, and it's not clear whether they all actually got mailed or whether they got intercepted and put in the trash. And that was, I haven't heard if there's been any resolution to that. I don't know if any of you guys have, but that'd be my only concern about mail ballot election is that if everyone's doing it, but again, I don't know that it's that unique because a lot of people do absentee ballots now anyway, but that'd be my only, at least, caution of
we could find out if that, if there's been resolution to that issue. But I don't know, you guys heard anything about those complaints since election day?
I heard about them before the, election, but I haven't heard anything about them since.
In my opinion, it's an all or nothing.
Oh, yeah, you're in that office. Have you guys heard anything?
I have not. You know, you hear the stories about it, but you would have the same issue with ballots, absentee ballots. I mean, once they leave our office, it's the responsibility of the voter. And whether they hand them to somebody else to bring them back themselves or mail them back, that's the responsibility of the voter.
Yeah, and if they don't get them in time, then they're not counted.
That's right.
So.
So what's the percentage of our absentee voters right now?
I believe it's real close to 50% if it's not over that. It just keeps growing and growing. It's getting to where, in my personal opinion, I think we should go to mail ballots. I know the traditionalist, and I'm one of them. I like the polls too, but right now we basically have a mail ballot election because of the absentees. We have the poll. We have a late ballot at the courthouse. So you've got three elections going on anyway if you have a poll election. With a mail ballot, you've got one election.
And you don't have bad roads keeping people away from the polling place, which is a possibility in November.
Do you know if the legislation specifies in terms of the counting, is it if they're postmarked by a certain date or if they're received by a certain date?
They have to be received by 8 o'clock on the election day.
And that's what the legislation, it wouldn't change that.
All this legislation, this is not sweeping legislation. This is a very simple bill. What it says is, please allow us, with the time frame and the money issue, to do a mail-in ballot for just this election. That's all it is. It's not to change election law for the state of Montana, widespread, or for any other election. It's for this one only.
But it will. I mean, if it's successful, then we're likely to go more towards Oregon, which is all mail ballot.
If it's successful,
it's a disaster, then that'll probably push it back for a long time.
Washington State as well does all mail ballots.
Do they? Mm-hmm. Let me just make some inquiries and find out if there's any concerns about the election day stuff, and I may be able to sign it. I just would have to do a little looking and find out what other people are hearing.
Well, let me know when you decide.
When are you sending it in?
As soon as possible. It's supposed to hit the floor any day now. So
is it in the House or the Senate?
It's a House bill, if I'm not mistaken. I didn't bring the email with me. So it's widely supported by MACO, clerk and recorder's treasurers. So we tend to try and stand together because it's good for the state of Montana.
I spent a lot of years in politics where we had concerns about it, but those might be a thing. So I'll be back to you shortly.
Thank you. I appreciate it. And here's the letter to Representative Flynn. The one to Senator Sales, I actually addressed it to Representative Flynn also. So same language. I'll just make that change and bring it to Board of Health at 3 o'clock.
Okay. Awesome. I'll hand these to you guys in a minute.
And do either one of you guys know what the estimated cost of this thing would be?
The savings would be at least $5,000. And I got that from Doug, and it's in that letter. The savings alone. The last election was 19,331, I think. It's also in that letter. So there would still be ancillary costs that are true either way.
Either way, yeah.
So, you know, those still stay. The printing costs, the, you know, overtime costs, that kind of thing. But it's just the savings. The thing is, it's going to save the state of Montana over $1 million. That adds up. It should be. So that's all I have on that. I'll get those other two letters and have them ready for us at 3, or that other letter from Sales.
Okay, do you want to wait to Corey? this year, this year. Yeah. How are you coming on that part?
I'll just need more time. Yeah, I'm just going to hand it to you in a minute here.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, may I make a comment? In all this stuff you've done today, which is your prerogative to do, but you still are not making any provisions to take care of the problems of extension, 4-H, meeting rooms for public meetings. And I ask that that not get forgotten in taking care of search and rescue.
Okay. Are you guys waiting on me?
Okay.
We shouldn't have to.
Good, because I'm
wicked. We can adjourn it when he has a chance. Yes, we adjourn at 2:02.
I've sat here too long to sit for one day, thank you.